Good evening, everyone. So in the last class, we were talking about general characteristics of concrete when cement is replaced with mineral admixtures, some potential benefits that concrete can obtain when it is replaced partially, when cement is replaced partially by mineral admixtures. We also talked about some methods of looking at the structure of the mineral additives and understanding their typical pozzolanic reactivities. And then we started talking about how fly ash can be collected in thermal power plants by the means of electrostatic precipitators. And the fact that you also get these days super classified or fly ash that is highly super classified in terms of the particle sizes that you collect from thermal power plants, you can actually grade the specific characteristics of fly ash with respect to the particle sizes. Okay? So these days you get increasingly fine particle sizes of fly ash, which sometimes in some markets are also sold as competitors to silica fume, which is a much finer cement replacement material. Okay. So in general, we know that fly ash is used as a mineral admixture or as a cementitious replacement in concrete. There are some cases where fly ash can also be used as a filler. So for instance, if your specification does not allow you to use a cement replacement material, very often construction companies or concrete producers tend to use fly ash as a replacement, partial replacement of the fine aggregate in the concrete. Okay, I'll tell you an instance. In one of the projects in Chennai, there was a need for concrete to be produced with a very low chloride ion permeability. Now, that's a test which we'll talk about later when we discuss about durability. So that's a specific durability test that the concrete needs to pass to be characterized or to be classified as durable for a particular environment. Now, unfortunately, the specs also said that you are not permitted the use of any cement replacement materials in this case. Now, the issue is this rapid chloride permeability test, the way that the test is set up, it is heavily in favor of concrete systems that incorporate mineral admixtures. So especially if you have silica bearing mineral admixtures like fly ash or slag, you get very good performance in that test. So this concrete producer now was in a dilemma what to do, because they could not use a cement replacement material. To get ordinary Portland cement to perform at that level of durability would mean that you need to go for a very high grade of concrete. That means totally your economy would be lost, because you've been asked to only produce M30 or M40 grade concrete. But to satisfy the durability criteria, you may have to actually go up to 60-70 megapascal grade. So the solution proposed was that they could use fly ash as a replacement for the fine aggregate. So that way they had fly ash in the system, but they were not showing it as an additive or a replacement of the cement. So they still had the same quantity of cement as they had in the control mixture, but all they did was they replaced part of your of the aggregate with fly ash. And this led to a performance that was as expected in terms of compressive strength as well as durability. So fly ash can be used as a filler, but in some cases, especially with high performance concrete or high strength concrete, when we need additional cementitious material, we don't want to replace the cement because our requirements for strength are quite extensive, especially in the early ages. Because of that, the fly ash can be used as a filler or an additive over and above the quantity of cement that we already have in the system. Okay? So that's something that people also do sometimes. The other use of fly ash is as a synthetic aggregate. Now, those of you who have visited our lab will know, I don't know how many of you have seen these red colored particles, which are small ball shaped particles which have been prepared in the lab. Those are by sintering the fly ash particles that are pelletized. So we have a drum in which fly ash is made to mix with water, a little bit of water, and also sometimes the pelletizing agent like a clay can be added to give sufficient cohesive characteristics to the particles to ball up into coarse aggregate sizes. And then these particles which are pelletized are then put in the furnace and burnt at a high temperature, around 1000 degrees Celsius. At that point, what happens is the silica and alumina and fly ash, they get sintered. That means that you form a ceramic bond. So the sintered fly ash particles form a very nice aggregate, a good lightweight aggregate actually. So sintering fly ash can result in the formation of artificial lightweight aggregate. And sometimes if you have type C fly ash, which is high calcium fly ash, you can even form these aggregates by simply pelletizing and then curing, just like you cure normal concrete, because then you end up forming CSH with these pozzolanic cementitious and pozzolanic systems. You can form that by normal curing also, and that process is called cold bonding, because it happens at regular temperatures. You don't really need to heat up the fly ash at all. We also talked about the fact earlier that the coarse fly ash does not fly out and is collected at the bottom of the boiler as bottom ash, and ultimately it's mixed with the ash that cannot be used later and then dumped into the pond ash, dumped as pond ash together. So this ash, which is coarser in nature, can also be ground much finer in the hope of making it more reactive or probably as a filler. So that process is called fly ash beneficiation. That means we simply do additional processing of this material to ensure that we get some performance characteristics out of it. Okay, so as per ASTM, the classification, ASTM is the American Society for Testing and Materials. As per ASTM classification, fly ash is classified as type C, type F. In India, we typically classify fly ash in terms of high calcium or low calcium, which essentially means the same. Type C is high calcium and type F is low calcium fly ash. However, in India, we would not call the fly ashes at type C or type F because the classification system as type C and F are based on ASTM. Okay. So type C is high calcium fly ash. It generally has around 10% to 20% calcium oxide, okay, typically 10% to 20% CO. And because of that significantly high proportion of calcium oxide, it possesses both cementitious and pozzolanic characteristics. Okay. So in terms of particle size, there is not much difference between type C and type F fly ash and probably even cement. Okay. Most of the particles of fly ash are in the range of cement also. So you have 10% to 15% of the material will be retained on a 45 micron sieve. That means nearly 90% of the material is finer than a 45 micron sieve. Okay. Very similar to what cement typically contains. Okay. And the fineness is typically represented in terms of Blaine air permeability, and that works out to be about 300 to 400 square meters per kilogram in the case of fly ash. In F fly ash, sometimes you may get smaller particle sizes, but that again depends on the efficiency of your collection from the ESPS, right? So you can even collect very small sizes which are much more reactive silica particles, but for the most part the type F and type C fly ashes that you get in the market would essentially be of this size range, which is quite similar to that of cement. In both cases, particles are solid spheres with an average particle size of about 15 to 20 microns. So the spherical particle shape of fly ash is what essentially helps it in providing better workability in a concrete system. Okay. Now that I have said that, I will also add one more aspect to that, that very often in the laboratory when we actually do the replacement of cement with fly ash, depending upon where the fly ash has been collected, we often find that the workability is actually reduced and not increased. But based on the particles, the shape of the particles, we expect the fly ash to have better workability in a concrete system. So these are the fly ash particles you can see here. Most of them are spherical particles. Some are small and some are large. And in some cases, you can get extremely large spherical particles also, which have a collection of these smaller fly ash solid spheres inside. Okay. So you can get all kinds of mixtures when you collect the fly ash. That's primarily because fly ash is flying out with the flue gas and there's some condensation which is happening along with the flue gas, and that leads to the formation of this hollow glassy spheres which can contain some solid particles of silica of fly ash based silica inside this. Okay. So these are the solid particles of fly ash inside a larger glassy, almost a hollow spherical particle of fly ash. So based on this, there's a lot of classifications that are done for the type of particles. So the solid and hollow spherical particles are actually seen in this picture. The small hollow spheres with entrapped gas are called sinospheres. So these are not the small hollow spheres, these are large hollow spheres and they are called plerospheres. So you have three types of particles inside. One is the large hollow spheres which contain the solid silica spheres which are essentially the reactive fly ash particles, right? And you also contain small hollow spheres which are called sinospheres. And these days most of the companies that are supplying fly ash are also trying to actually collect the sinospheres separately because you can sell the sinospheres as a lightweight aggregate. Okay, so sinospheres can be quite useful as lightweight aggregate. Okay, because obviously being hollow they are light in weight, so they can be used as lightweight aggregate. What other types of lightweight aggregate do you know of apart from sintered fly ash and sinospheres? Leica is basically sintered fly ash. Sintered fly ash, that's a commercial name, Leica, or light tag rather, light tag. Sorry, vermiculite. Yeah, and somebody said pumice, which is a volcanic rock, right? Or sometimes you can also have other expanded shale is basically the type of lightweight aggregate that you can also get in the market. Okay. So again, lightweight concrete incorporates different types of lightweight aggregate. So there are obviously very specific uses that you can use these lightweight aggregates for. Okay. Now, again, this is presenting you an image of fly ash particles which is not from a secondary electron image. That means, we are not seeing the morphology, but we are rather seeing a polished section of a collection of fly ash particles together. Okay. So, you see here, what I want to show you in this picture is the difference between a fly ash that is simply collected from a thermal power plant versus a fly ash that is actually collected and then processed. On the left image is a class F fly ash from Ennore, which is northern part of Chennai in Tamil Nadu. And essentially, you can see the kind of particles that you see. There is a lot of these hollow spherical particles. You see, this is actually a hollow spherical particle where the glass on the surface has been broken. Okay, you see again another hollow particle where the glass is actually broken on the surface. There are smaller solid particles also, which are the ones which we really need for better reactivity. On the right hand side, you will see a P100 fly ash, which is actually a commercial high performance fly ash, which is manufactured or rather processed and sold from Dirk India, which is actually now owned by Ambuja, the company that makes the cement. Of course, Ambuja is now owned by Lafarge Holcim, so it's a long chain of ownership. So right now it's Lafarge Holcim, okay, it's no longer Dirk India. So P100 fly ash is actually the regular cement grade fly ash which is obtained from Dirk India, and you can very clearly see the extent of smaller particles which are present in this case are much greater than the extent of smaller particles that you see from the fly ash that is randomly collected from the thermal power plant. Okay. So, what I want to point out with this is that very often the kind of fly ash that you find at ready mix concrete industries, the fly ash that they store in their silos is of this type, which is the bulk supply from the thermal power plants. Now, this is the reason why a lot of RMC, when they use fly ash, the characteristic, the quality of the concrete is sometimes difficult to maintain at a very specific level. In other words, there is a very large variability in the properties that is brought about by the use of this as collected fly ash. Okay. But the processed fly ash, on the other hand, is the one that behaves the same way irrespective of where you are applying it. Now, the problem obviously is what? The problem of using processed fly ash. Obviously, it is costly, right? You spend a lot more money in trying to get this processed fly ash, and very often, because we typically take fly ash as being a material that is available free of cost except the transportation charges that we pay for it, sometimes we are not willing to pay additional cost for the processing. So, unfortunately, this creates a condition where you have the possibility to choose between an unprocessed or a processed fly ash, and if economic considerations are actually driving your project, then you will end up choosing the unprocessed fly ash and end up having a much more variable concrete mixture throughout your construction project. In the West, there is no such thing as an unprocessed fly ash. You actually get everything in the form of a processed fly ash. So, they sell it as a value added product. In fact, you can get fly ash also in bags like cement. Cement is obtained in 50 kilogram bags, but fly ash typically is sold in 25 kilogram bags. Okay, you can find fly ash bags also in the market. So, processed fly ash is better in terms of obtaining concrete of a good quality consistently. Okay, but if you can live with the variability, obviously you can go with the unprocessed fly ash, which is bulk supplied from the thermal power plants. Now, obviously, there is a business opportunity here. There is a lot of scope of actually collecting fly ash, processing it, especially in terms of the sizes, classifying it in terms of sizes. So, actually, this Dirk India, they sell different types of fly ash. They sell a P63, P100 and P500, which are increasing in the levels of fineness of the fly ash particles. So, you get smaller and smaller particles as you move from P63 to P500. What this enables a concrete producer to do is use a combination of characteristics that are required to produce specific types of concrete. For example, we are currently doing a project in our lab which deals with the production of high performance grouts. So, these grouts are intended to fill up the post-tensioning cable strands. So, the post-tension strands, you know that after you put the strands and the sheathing is there, you need to cover up that area properly, otherwise your strands will be liable to corrosion, right? You'll have a lot of problems with corrosion in the long run. So, if you don't fill up that space well with the grout, we can create a lot of problems in your pre-stressed concrete, right? So, how do you fill up a good quality grout is by ensuring that you can produce it with particles which are of very small sizes, so that they can flow long distances into the sheathing and fill up the area around your pre-stressing strands. And this can be done with the high fineness fly ash materials, which can be used as partial replacement for cement. Of course, you do need cement to produce the kind of characteristics that you need in terms of the strength and so on, but you can produce this kind of a material with a large proportion of cement replaced with fly ash. And mostly you can use different combinations also to ensure that you get the best flow characteristics as well as the best filling characteristics of the grout, okay. So very often people, when they use unprocessed fly ash, they complain of some black coloration on the surface of the concrete, and that black coloration indicates that there is a significant amount of unburnt carbon that may be still present in the fly ash, okay. Now we know that fly ash is obtained in a thermal power plant, so the coal is being burnt off, but then some very small particles of carbon may fly out with the fly ash and get collected in the ESPs. So those are the unburnt carbon particles. So when you are actually using fly ash for your concrete, you need to first conduct a loss and ignition test to determine the extent of unburnt carbon that is present in your system, okay. So loss and ignition test needs to be done as a means of quality control of the fly ash. If the LOI is too high, then this unburnt carbon can actually create a lot of problems, not just aesthetic problems of coming up to the surface and causing discoloration, but it can also lead to interference with the air entraining agent and leading to poor air void parameters. Now in terms of hydration, there is not too much data on what unburnt carbon does to the actual hydration characteristics of the cement, but in general people have associated also the unburnt carbon presence to lowering the strength characteristics of the concrete with fly ashes. So that can also happen to some extent, but essentially this is something that needs some degree of control, which is what the processing is able to bring about also. And of course the other aspects to look at is the sulfate content, because sometimes coal may have some sulfates which can get into the fly ash, magnesium oxide content, alkali content and moisture content of the fly ash. And of course if you remember, we had this discussion with the person in the cement plant about the use of coal versus pet coke in the cement plant, okay. So pet coke can actually bring in a lot more sulfur in your mix. So if you are trying to use the ash that is generated from the cement kiln, you need to be very careful about how much sulfate that is actually going to bring up into your system, okay. Fly ash is typically from thermal power plants. If you are burning coal, you are not going to get that much of sulfur in the system. Okay, and you of course remember that the moisture content of fly ash can also be significantly high sometimes, especially in the final stages of cement manufacture when you are doing the blending with the clinker and grinding, right. You remember that there was some excess heat from the kiln process that was actually supplied to even drying up this moisture from the fly ash. So that is also an important part of the final grinding stage, because this moisture in the fly ash can otherwise interfere with the kind of grinding that we want between the clinker and the fly ash particles. So what are the effects on fresh concrete properties? You know very well about this, that when we use fly ash as cement replacement, there is a lowered rate of reaction, and because of which setting happens much slower. So setting time is increased typically when fly ash is used as a cement replacement. The workability and flow of concrete are increased because of the spherical particle shape of fly ash particles, and essentially the spherical particles are acting like ball bearings, increasing the flowability of your concrete. Again, I say this with the caveat that you actually have to test it to find out whether you are actually getting this effect or not. Very often we have seen the opposite effect of having reduced the workability when cement was replaced with fly ash. Now that sometimes happens when you are not very careful about where you are collecting your fly ash, because even in a thermal power plant like I showed in the previous picture here, you can actually have several stages of collection. You see there are 4 ESPs in a row here in this thermal power plant, and depending upon which ESP you are taking your fly ash from, you will get a mixture of coarse or fine particle characteristics. So again, that is something that you may need to qualify properly to get the best material for substitution of the cement, okay. So bleeding and segregation are usually reduced for well proportioned fly ash concrete, because again what you are doing here is replacing cement with fly ash. Fly ash has a lower specific gravity. So specific gravity of fly ash is typically about 2.2, whereas cement has 3.15. So if you are replacing with a material that has a lower specific gravity, the overall volume of the paste is going to increase. So you have more fines in your system. So volume of fines in your system is now higher, which results in an improved resistance to bleeding and segregation, okay. So when you do a mass replacement of the cement with fly ash, you are going to be increasing the paste volume. Now that can lead to interesting considerations. One is obviously that your bleeding and segregation are going to get reduced, but the other aspect, if you remember we discussed this earlier, that the creep and shrinkage of concrete are dependent on the extent of aggregate that you have in your system. So the amount of paste that is there in the system is the one, is the paste is the part which is going to shrink or creep when a sustained load is there. So when you have greater amount of paste, there is a good chance that you may get higher creep and shrinkage. Of course, the research data is not that conclusive with respect to that, because very often we tend to design based on different characteristics. One is we design based on an equivalent strength level, right. So for example, if I design an M30 concrete with plain cement, if I have to design the same M30 concrete with fly ash, what should I do with the water cement ratio? I'll have to reduce it slightly, right, because I know that fly ash reaction is slower. I'll be gaining strength at a much slower rate if I use the same quantity of cement or water cement ratio. So if I lower the water cement ratio slightly and produce concrete at the same strength grade, then my creep and shrinkage may not be affected significantly, okay. The resistance to deformation may be quite similar in that case, right. But if I am just replacing cement at the same water cement ratio, if I am replacing cement with fly ash, then I expect that my creep and shrinkage will actually go up as opposed to plain cement. So again, this is giving you the results of a research study where it was shown that for a particular water cement ratio of 0.42, for instance, when fly ash was used as a substitution, okay, there was a retardation in the setting. So these first two curves here, this curve here is for 0.42, this next curve is actually for plain cement paste with 0.3 cement water cement ratio. So at all these mixes are the mixes with fly ash. So what this is telling you is the penetration resistance of the cement paste with respect to time. And you can see that as the quantity of fly ash replaced increases, you have 30% to 40% fly ash as a replacement for the cement. As that quantity of fly ash replacement is increased, the setting time also increases. You have more and more slower hydration, because of which you have increase in the setting time, okay. So very often what people do is to compensate for that increased setting time, a fine additive like silica fume or fine limestone can be used as a very small replacement, and that can actually push your fly ash performance to more acceptable levels. For example, this orange and blue curves are basically with fly ash and limestone together, small particles of limestone together, okay. So again, I will talk mainly about limestone based systems a little bit later, but to compensate for this delay in setting with fly ash, oftentimes you can use fine particulate systems like silica fume or limestone. Or of course, as you rightly as you were rightly mentioning earlier, we can lower the water cement ratio to improve the early age performance, okay. When we use fly ash as a replacement for cement, we can lower the water cement ratio for the equivalent performance that we get with the cement. As far as hardened concrete is concerned, we expect a delay in the strength gain characteristics. We talked about this earlier, that with type of fly ash at 20% to 30%, it will take nearly 14 to 28 days for your concrete to achieve similar strength characteristics as a plain concrete, okay. So but then if you are curing for a long period of time, the ultimate strengths, which means that the strength beyond 28 days, 56 days, 90 days, up to 1 year, those strengths can be significantly improved as compared to plain cement, because you know that fly ash reaction will continue to happen until there is lime available from the cement system, okay. Creep and shrinkage are generally higher. Again, we discussed this primarily when mass replacement is done, but there is a lot of issues with how we can actually judge the data with fly ash. Do you do that on an equivalent water cement ratio basis or an equivalent strength basis, okay. When air entrained concrete has fly ash, you generally need a little bit extra air entraining agent to entrain the same quantity of air in fly ash concrete. Again, this is because you have some carbon, presence of unburned carbon in your fly ash that can interfere with the action of the air entraining agent, okay. Again, with sulfate resistance, the results are inconclusive. We will talk a little bit about this in the chapter on durability. And like all other pozzolanic materials, the expansion due to alkali silica reaction can be reduced significantly when fly ash is used as a replacement for Portland cement, because again, when you are replacing Portland cement, you are reducing the alkali content in your system, and if you have lesser alkalis, you do not have as much potential for ASR. So in specialized applications like high strength concrete, fly ash can be used as an additional material. As I said, you do not use it as a replacement for cement, but as a additive over and above the existent cement quantity in the cement. Roller compacted concrete is another application where fly ash usage can be quite beneficial You know that in roller compaction, what we do is we lay a layer of the concrete, compact it using rollers, and then the next layer is built on it, and so on and so forth. So this is especially used for pavements or for dams, okay. And the advantage with fly ash there is, when you have two layers of RCC or roller compacted concrete, there is improved bonding between these layers when fly ash is used. There is enough data to show that, okay. There is another specialized application of fly ash in controlled low strength material. Now that is quite an interesting concept. Why would we control the strength of the concrete to be low? In what applications? For example, backfilling, right, or trench filling applications or pipe bedding applications. When you are laying a pipe inside the ground, sometimes we need to spend a lot of energy trying to compact the soil around it to create the bedding for the pipe. Instead of that, if you use a highly flowable material to go and occupy that volume, then the pipe can be easily bedded. And the advantage of this low strength material is that you can actually relay the pipe or recover the pipe by digging through the through this material as it is low strength. So we are talking primarily about 1 to 8 megapascal strength, 1 to 8 megapascal strength. So in these kind of materials, fly ash is typically 90% and only 10% is cement. In controlled low strength materials, the binder is made up of 90% fly ash and only 10% of cement. So cement you need only minimally to provide some little hydration, whereas fly ash is mostly responsible for the fine particles in the system which provides the flowability in the system. Again, synthetic aggregate we already talked about, and fly ash is also used for manufacture of bricks. So in fact, the Ministry of Environment and Forests has actually made it mandatory for all brick manufacturing units to only use fly ash if they are within a certain distance from the thermal power plants, okay. So brick manufacturing units are increasingly using fly ash either as a partial replacement for clay, or they are producing fly ash bricks, that means fly ash concrete bricks. They produce concrete with fly ash and simply make it into a brick shape. So in IIT, we shifted from red clay brick to fly ash brick quite a few years ago, nearly about I think 10 years ago we made the shift from red clay bricks to fly ash bricks. So all our projects typically will only use fly ash bricks, okay. But then when I say fly ash bricks, it is fly ash concrete bricks. So, in spite of years and years of research with fly ash, in spite of years and years of usage of fly ash, we still have difficulty in selling fly ash for typical construction applications, especially when large infrastructure projects are involved, where there are clients who are from the government. Very often they do not want to use fly ash, again because there are conservative attitudes, people do not want to use systems which are relatively new, and fly ash is 100 years old, so I do not call it relatively new. Well, they can say cement is 200 years old, so fly ash is newer than cement. There is difficult quality assurance, that's one major issue with fly ash, because you get high degree of variability in the concrete. Again, it leads to storage problems, you need to store fly ash in a separate silo, and very often if you get moist fly ash, how well can you use it in concrete can be quite questionable, okay. Again, marketing could be some of the reason why fly ash is not used as much. We call it a waste instead of a pozzolan or a cement. Part of this problem will go away if we do not rely on the supplied fly ash and we only get the processed fly ash. So there we are getting a value added product. So we know we are paying a value, we are paying some amount for this. So that will bring about a slightly better attitude on the parts of people who are not really willing to accept cement replacement materials. So anything that is free does not really have a value, right. Do you agree with me? If your education made free, would that be okay with you, or you would not really take it seriously, no? It's free, it'll come one day, what's the big deal, right? If you're paying a premium price for it, you know that you need to actually work to get your money's worth. So anything that is free really does not have a great value, and I'm not saying that for everything in terms of let me just confine myself to materials and civil engineering, okay. So there are obviously issues of transportation with fly ash. Whenever the fly ash has to be transported to more than 40 to 50 kilometers, maybe even 100 kilometers, it becomes uneconomical to use in construction projects. So you have to look at the geographical map of the country, decide where fly ash can be useful, and try to push for fly ash usage in those segments only. Otherwise, what will happen is if you try to push it everywhere, then the transportation costs will become too high for justifying the usage of fly ash in concrete for all the difficulties that you need to encounter with fly ash as a cement replacement. So, the next admixture that we will consider is silica fume, or often it is called micro silica. Now, silica fume as opposed to fly ash, which is again the same silica only, but as opposed to fly ash, silica fume is being obtained from a very specialized industry, and that is the ferrosilicon industry, where they make silicon metal from silicon bearing alloys. So, ferrosilicon alloys are actually mined and then these are processed to get the silicon metal. And based on the type of alloy, you can actually get different purities of silica fume. So, you can get anywhere between 20% and 100% of silica content in your silica fume depending upon the type of alloy that you are choosing. Okay. So, again the process is involving a very high temperature calcination. Obviously, you have the raw materials, which is your carbon, right, and the quartz, which are sintered or smelted together at a very high temperature, 2000 degrees Celsius. So, this leads to the formation of silicon metal by this reaction. Basically, your silica and carbon are combining and the oxide is taken away by the carbon as CO, carbon monoxide, and then you get the silicon metal. But some of the silica, which is extremely fine, basically flies off with the off gas and is collected in the baghouse filter. Okay, we saw the baghouse filter in the cement plant, if you remember. So, that is another system of collecting very fine particulate matter, just like your electrostatic precipitators. Okay. So, from the baghouse filter, we get the as produced silica fume, the particles of silica that are collected from this process. So, again this silica fume, after it is collected over the furnace, it is transferred, cooled and trapped physically with the baghouse filter. So, here this picture is showing the baghouse filter in this process. So, here the large pipe on this left is bringing the silica fume to the furnaces. The vertical elements are cyclones, which are used to remove the oversize and other unwanted materials that are present in this system. Okay. This large building is the baghouse, okay, where the silica fume is actually captured. So, this is just giving you a basic indication of what happens in a baghouse. So, the baghouse, as the name implies, is intended for collection of fine particulate matter with the help of bags. Okay. So, these bags are actually put inside this dust collector. So, you have the dust which is coming in at one end and then you have the fan which is driving out the gases at the other end. So, essentially all the dust is collected through this baghouse and then it is removed and disposed in most cases, but in this case obviously you want to make use of the silica fume, that is why we are going to be packaging it. The problem with silica fume is that when you collect the powder as is, it has a very light characteristic and very fine particle size. We are talking about submicron size particles. Okay. Because of that, it becomes very difficult to handle, and I have first hand experience with this. I was doing my BTech project here and at that point I was working on high strength concrete, and at the during those days there was no commercial manufacturer of silica fume available in India. So, today you get, of course, for projects if you want silica fume, you can get one of the large commercial manufacturers like Elkem or Corniche or something like that. They supply the silica fume if you want to buy it, but in those days we had to actually scrounge around to get some silica fume for doing research. So, I found this company in Andhra Pradesh which was doing some silicon metal processing, and I asked a friend to ship me a bag of 10 kilograms of silica fume. Now, I was prepared to just bring it back with me in my backpack. When I went and collected this from the customs warehouse or wherever it was, go down where it was available, I found that this bag was huge. It was this big and this bulky, all 10 kilograms of material. Because of this fine particle size, again I had no clue about what silica fume should be like at that point of time. I had only read about it in papers, I had never seen it personally. So, I got this bag and I got it in an auto bag with me. In those days, spending on an auto for a long distance would have meant a lot of money. I ultimately ended up getting a lot of this powder all over myself also. I was coming back looking totally white with the silica fume. Anyway, so gone are those days where you had to go and collect these materials, but now you can actually get them delivered to your doorstep. You get the primary silica fumes available in the market are in the form of condensed or dry densified silica fume. So, where they take these fine particles of silica fume and compact them under pressure and make them into dry densified particles, which are more like cement size particles. As a result, they can actually end up packing that better in bags, and you can get silica fume in 25 kilogram bags typically. But what is important is, when you mix this in concrete, you need an efficient superplasticizer to deflocculate the condensed particles of silica fume and convert that into the finer particles that we really want in the system, because the finer particles are the ones which are reactive silica, which give the high quality filler characteristics. So, if you do not deflocculate them, we are not going to get the required characteristic that we want. Secondly, as I had talked about this earlier, that when we do mixing of the concrete, the abrasive action of the aggregate can also lead to further deflocculation of these particles. So, that abrasive action is required, so that you need to mix a longer time. When you have silica fume concrete, you need to cause your concrete mix to go on for a longer time as opposed to plain cement, right. I think we had a discussion earlier about the mixing time with concrete in an RMC, that typically they do 15 to 30 seconds, which is really very small when we are dealing with something like silica fume. So, we need at least 4 to 5 minutes of good quality mixing to bring out these particles in a better way. Now, in the West, I have seen sometimes the silica fume being available as a slurry, where they simply make a suspension of the silica fume, where they use nearly 50% water and use a chemical agent to stabilize the silica fume in suspension. The problem with the slurry obviously is that you will have storage issues. You need to have very large tanks to store this material, and if a temperature is dropping too low, then you will start gelling up this material inside the slurry. So, there is always a problem with the use of slurry, but the advantage obviously is that when you use this in concrete, you do not have to worry about dispersion. You have an automatic dispersion of the silica fume. So, here these are the different forms. So, you see this is the as collected powder. This is the dry densified powder, you can see. Okay, so, you can very clearly see the distinction in the characteristics. So, here you have dust flying all over the place, and in fact, in the past, when before dry densified powders were used, there was a lot of health issues related to the handling of silica fume, because these fine particles of silica can get into your respiratory tract and lead to problems like silicosis and other respiratory issues. Okay. So, the dry densified form is a lot more easier to handle, or of course, you can actually get the slurry of the silica fume. The color of silica fume is governed by the extent of purity that it has. If it has more silica, if it is more pure, it will be the white quality. If it is less pure, that means about 80 to 85% or 90% silica, it will be the gray colored silica fume. Okay. Now, generally there is a tendency when we use silica fume that it tends to make your concrete a lot more darker as opposed to plain cement. Instead of using plain cement, when you use silica fume, your concrete ends up becoming a lot more darker. That is primarily because most of the standard material is of a gray shade that is a little bit darker than cement. So, when you substitute cement with silica fume, you will end up with a darker color of the concrete. Now, that depends on where you are geographically, that can be an advantage or a disadvantage. Okay. In India, mostly a darker color concrete is an advantage, because people think that if the concrete is light, they do not put enough cement in it. If you go to the northern European countries, they want everything to be white, right. So, all the concrete there, I mean they do a color classification, and they reject concrete which is of a darker shade than what they actually want. So, that is why the use of slag also can be problematic in India, because slag leads to a whiter color in your concrete. So, while that is highly acceptable in a country like England, where they want very nicely colored concrete surfaces, in India using slag, people are not used to the lighter color of the concrete. So, they start suspecting that people are not, the concrete producer has not put in enough cement. If you go to the northeast, where no fly ash is available, slag is very popular, and they are using blended slag cement for a long period of time. So, there the lighter color of concrete is obviously more preferred. So, I do not know what is good, what is not, but that is how our preferences are. But what we have to understand as concrete technologists is the color is only reflective of what is actually inside. It is not really doing anything to the quality of the concrete. Okay, I think we are at the end of this session. We will continue our discussion on silica fume and then slag and the other mineral admixtures in the next class, which is on Tuesday.